In the culture war, there are no winners, just podcasters. Only a few are willing to risk their lives in the face of some of the dumbest ideas to have ever captured human civilization. Every week, I, Meghan Daum, along with my partner, Sarahhaider, humbly accept this mission in order to bring you conversations that are equal parts stunning, brave, and unhinged.
Just remember, there's a special place in hell for women who don't help each other.
Hi, everyone. I'm Meghan. I'm here with Sarah. We have an exceptionally stunning and brave guest in this episode. No, he's a little disappointingly not unhinged,
actually. That was us. He's extremely rational. You guys know him. Coleman Hughes,
trombone
writer,
player,
speaker, savant.
Yeah.
Trombone player. He can do everything. Coleman can do it all.
Yeah, he kind of just sits there.
Although on this conversation, he just talks.
This conversation is notable too, because it's in person. We did it in the studio. And it was also the first time that you and I met.
It was. Mm-hmm. It was. We had just met an hour before. Not even. I had just come into the studio and that was us meeting for the first time. And then we sat down and we recorded this thing with Coleman and it was great. I thought it was a great conversation. Yeah. It went on for a lot longer than we anticipated, which is always a good sign if you're going on for some time. We covered a range of topics.
Well, I asked him about his origin story. That was one of the things that I was interested. I'm always curious how people kind of found their way to the heterodoxy. There's often some kind of catalyst. In some cases, it's because somebody got in trouble. They found themselves canceled in some way. But that was not the case for him. So he has some, his story there is quite interesting. So talked about that. What else? We talked a little bit about music. I think we talked a little bit about...
We talked about heterodoxy. We talked about dating, which was fun with somebody like him.
Yeah.
I think it's easy for him to get dates. But then he gets some weird dates. He has particular challenges specific to him. So anyway, it was a wonderful conversation, wide ranging, interesting. And we were all in person. So that was nice. So we hope that you guys will enjoy.
Yeah. So here it is, our conversation with Coleman Hughes.
How you guys doing?
Well, how are you doing?
Yeah. I'm great.
Whose show is this? Who's interviewing who?
So you thought it was your show. I thought it was my show. Let's just make it both of our shows.
Well, you're the one in the beanie.
That's
so
true.
You must be the host.
I'm dressed in my podcasting uniform as a male.
Did you only start wearing a beanie when you started podcasting?
Well, it's actually, you have to. It's part of the regulation in New York to get your podcasting license as a man. They hand you your beanie.
Wait, you have a license?
At the DMV, yeah.
We don't qualify for licenses yet.
Not yet.
Women
not in the podcasting world.
Well, look, did you see this article recently in the New York Times about why you should not date a podcast bro?
Yes.
I heard about it. Yeah.
Yeah. There was a whole article about why saying you have a podcast is the biggest turnoff for women in the dating market right now. And you should basically just stay away from podcasting guys.
I felt very attacked. I felt very erased by that mm-hmm. article.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. I saw that you tweeted that.
I did.
It was why a woman who was talking about how she dated a guy, but she forgave him for being a podcast, or he didn't reveal that he had a podcast until they had been dating for a while.
She catfished him as a podcaster.
She did?
Or he catfished her, rather, by saying he wasn't a podcast bro and then turned out to be a podcast bro, and guys don't include it in their bio. And
what's so wrong about it? Like, what...
Well, I mean, the idea is if you have a podcast as a guy, then you're Andrew Tate.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you're a misogynist and you're horrible and you can't find the clitoris and all this
well,
stuff.
Well, I mean, if you spend too much time podcasting, you can't find any human body part.
I don't understand these kinds of articles that are just one woman's dating experience, you know? Like,
as
she had a bad date and now it's an article.
Yeah.
And
now it's an article
about
the whole world. And it's true about all of society.
Yeah.
Because on the other hand, I felt like in a way, maybe this makes it kind of dangerous and sexy to be a podcaster. Mm. it might actually backfire. Like if you tell women, oh, you shouldn't date this one type of guy, they're too dangerous. I feel like in a way that raises my capital.
So what about like Michael Barbaro and Ezra Klein? Like they're podcasters, right?
Yeah.
And so maybe this is like,
but they're podcasters that them. Hard, like kind of hard signal their feminism in some ways.
I see.
Which yeah. so they wouldn't really be included in this, nor would I. I mean, I'm not like a shock jock podcaster type.
But you have like heterodox opinions like
yeah.
us.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
So actually like one of the things I think like I was really curious about and wanted to talk to you about is, you know, what's it been like for you as a young guy in a very liberal, like liberal city, mm-hmm. Who is kind of a star in this heterodox space, mm-hmm. and what's it like to be
like, is it
know,
hard
dating?
For, is it hard
world?
For him to get
like,
dates? Is that
yeah,
what you're asking?
Kind of, yeah.
So I have a girlfriend, but yeah. I was single for quite a while during this period of my life, and I would so like in New York City, it's not necessarily an advantage to be a writer and podcaster with the opinions that I have, mm-hmm. because basically what would happen is this: I would go on a date, right? I would match with somebody on Tinder or Hinge, go on a first date, and just be basically waiting for the shoe to drop in terms of I Googled you. I saw you testify before Congress. I read your article for Quillette. I read your article for New York Times or whatever. I disagree with it. Why do you think racism doesn't exist? Which I've never said. I had one back when I was in college. This probably would have been closer to the time I met you, like 4 or 5 years ago. I matched with a girl at Columbia who went to Columbia as well, and she liked a jazz group that I play in. She was like a huge fan of the Mingus Big Band, which is this jazz group I've been playing in downtown in New York since I was 16. So I was like, oh, wow, that's like amazing. Like she's already a fan of something. And it just came up naturally. And I happened
oh,
to.
Wow.
So I was like, oh, like this is going to be
You're
great.
In.
I'm in. Easy money. So we were continuing to talk. And eventually she says, oh, what else do you do? I say, oh, I'm a writer. She reads my article, says, sorry, I cannot go on a date with you because I can't be with someone. I can't go on a date with someone who thinks racism isn't real.
Oh.
You know?
Oh.
But, so it's a
so
double
did you,
it's a
did
double
you decide
edge
to like
it's
disclose it then like right in the beginning just like as you match with somebody you're like hey
it's kind of it's
Google
kind of an
first,
ethical thing then, like it's like having an STD like should you disclose it
yeah.
Heterodox is kind of
because
like
your opinions do spread through sex
that
just
yes,
like STDs a, that's yeah. true
through exposure definitely
yeah.
you could
sure.
probably
yeah.
be sued if you give your heterodoxy to somebody else without
that's
disclosing
right.
it first
yeah. If you make someone a Republican, that's like a...
All those people that I've turned on to the fifth column over the years, oof. They could still come back and sue me.
They could do a class action suit.
It's true. It's true. So wait, this girl, so you hadn't even gone on a date.
We hadn't even gone on a date, but she was super excited initially to go on a date with me because I was like in this band that she loved, right? She said, I asked her like, oh, what is your favorite jazz group? And it happened to be the one that I was
wow.
in, right? And not even that was enough to counteract the political ideology difference. On the other hand, being as a young man, having a career that is far more advanced than most young men my age is definitely appealing mm-hmm. to women. And like having my quote unquote shit together mm-hmm. to the degree that I do, whatever degree that is, mm-hmm. that was definitely a plus when I was single. So it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah. So, but do you feel like female podcasters are really hot? Like, would they be a big commodity or no? It's kind of, is it like kind of like a turn off?
To me or to?
I don't know, just anybody generally.
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Do you?
It depends. It depends your persona when you're podcasting. Like, you could have a very attractive persona when podcasting.
Well, not
as
no,
as a woman.
Not really.
I think you could.
I think it's like so? It's like being a conservative woman. You know, like it doesn't harm you that much. It doesn't harm you the way.
Right. You think men would like it?
I have a friend. My friend, a very good friend of mine, dates a female podcaster, and she has a big podcast. And I've never gotten the sense that that's like a demerit.
Problem. Right.
Yeah. No.
So, but I feel like heterodox women would have an advantage because the men would be relieved that they weren't going to be me too'd by her or something like that.
This is probably true. I mean, I think it's definitely first of all, there's a huge gender component to political ideology, which my understanding is that used to go in the opposite direction. Like women at one point were on average more conservative than men many, many decades ago. And at least for younger Americans, that profile has flipped, which is interesting if true. But I do think it's if I understand that somebody says something on a first date that indicates to me that they're not like a censorious woke person, that I definitely breathe easier.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, like I remember another date I went on when I was in college, and we tried to go to some restaurant, ended up going to Chipotle, which was whatever, not my best.
Look, moment, it's college. It's, I'm amazed you would go to any restaurant.
I would have done
that. As an undergraduate,
you
joined Chipotle, girls at restaurants.
Mm. And like 5 minutes into it, we're talking about, oh, what are you into? What am I? Blah, blah, blah. And she says, I'm writing a thesis on the intersection of racism and capitalism.
Mm-mm. Yeah, that's
and I was
yeah,
like,
you gotta get out of there.
Oh God, am
you're
I gonna
be me too'd by being in that room with her?
Yeah,
like, it's too late.
That's like am a I, Mad I, Lib. Yeah. Like I am writing a thesis on the intersection between blank.
Yeah.
And blank
intersection, like that word. It's one of those words, like marginalized intersection.
Right.
Like you see it anywhere and. You know that like they've absorbed the language, so they've probably absorbed the ideology, and you just need to get out of there. I think it's like I only dated for like I was only on the dating space for maybe like 2 months before I got into another
the dating space
relationship.
Locked
and
it down
that's
quick.
It. And yeah, I'm what?
The dating space?
What?
That's hilarious. It's like the dating
the
scene.
Dating
the how
pool,
that is so of our moment
pond,
that you would call
okay.
That it would be called the dating space.
The dating universe.
Scene.
The dating
scene.
Okay.
That's
all right,
what
the
we
dating scene.
Said in my day.
yeah. But I signed up for a website like before there were apps, but when there were just like online like dating websites. And I put in atheist. And I remember at first I didn't add that in there. I just put like not religious or something. And then I changed it to atheist. And I remember my inbox was suddenly flooded with like all these guys. And then I realized, oh, there's like no women that are willing to put that on their profile. And there's like a whole horde of men that are like, oh, my God, like so amazing. Wonderful.
I have to marry
wow.
Her
yeah,
yeah.
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 It was crazy. So I think that'd
no,
be similar to being
big...
a heterodox woman.
I think
yeah.
so.
You know, like because. Left-wing men aren't afraid of you and right-wing men aren't afraid of you. You
right.
know what I mean? Like,
right.
Right. If somebody puts their pronouns in their profile, do you overlook that? Because I think sometimes men feel that they have to or they're so clueless. Like if they're not aware of the stuff at all, if the app asks for the pronouns, they're just going to be like, oh, yeah, he, him, whatever. Mm. They don't
know. Depends what a man is looking for. If you're just looking for casual hookups, I think most men are pretty happy for you to like believe whatever.
it doesn't matter.
Like I have a friend. Yeah. This is one of my favorite stories. One of my best friends from college. He is a conservative, and he used to have a picture of Reagan in his dorm room. Right.
Wow.
But when he would bring a girl over, which was often in those days, he would turn it over. And
it would be a picture of Bernie Sanders.
Exactly.
Get laid, like get laid instantly. Yeah.
But then if he liked a girl and it was like they went on a couple dates, eventually he would choose the moment to like
reveal
himself and see whether he was accepted or not. Mm-hmm. And that was the crucial moment. But in those first few instances, I think most guys who aren't looking for something serious are just happy to say like, oh, look, you got pronouns in your brow. Maybe I'll make a little innocent joke about it because like I'm not trying to have a Socratic dialogue with you. So like, for example, that the girl that said she was into like the intersection of racism and capitalism. I remember I just had this moment where it was like, am I going to tell her about all my critiques of the concept that racism and capitalism are linked from my hundreds of pages of reading and like furious 30 page self Google Docs on this specific issue? Or am I just going to keep the peace and not text her again?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think I chose the second one because I was like,
Now, are these like white girls who...
This was a black girl.
This
was
a black girl. Okay. Yeah. But do you have
the
like...
The other one was a white girl that canceled on me.
Do you think that you were tending to get like some woke white girls who wanted to date you because you were a black guy?
A little bit. Yeah. I mean, I that thought has been in the back of my head at times. I try not to, you know, like prejudge anyone, but I definitely do think that that's like a phenomenon.
Because it would be a great feather in their cap.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then lo and behold, you meet Coleman
Hughes.
You're waiting to get like this like woke black dude to piss your daddy off.
It's so great.
And then it's Coleman Hughes.
And like, the daddies would love you.
Yeah, exactly.
Their dads would love
exactly.
you.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
I'm glad I don't have to deal with that. Oh my gosh. That sounds horrible.
Yeah. To deal with.
Well, also, just as a woman, I don't think men care that much. Like, regardless of, if, so long as you accept their politics, like,
yeah.
You tell me about how you feel about these. If that girl, the intersectionality of whatever, racism, capitalism woman, mm-hmm. If she said, you know what, this is what I think, it's cool what you think.
Yeah.
You know, I respect you.
I wouldn't mind, care.
Right?
It might even be nice to have that kind of, like a deep bond and, but have a difference of opinion.
Yeah.
Do you think you can handle that, though? Like, if the person, could you be long term with somebody who wasn't at least on
really
the same page?
It would really depend how sane in what style they held their opinions,
right,
and in what style they engaged.
Yeah, because I interviewed John McWhorter on my podcast, a couple of years ago, and he was sort of recently divorced, and he was like dating, and I asked him like, could you? Be in a relationship with somebody who wasn't like really into this stuff or like, you know, very much opposed to you. And I think he said, I don't want to feel like I have to censor myself. Like, I don't want to be walking on eggshells. And if I'm going to be like, you know, cooking dinner and having a glass of wine, I want to be able to like talk about my day and all the people who came after me.
But that's like
whatever.
A feature of modern society. I think people used to have disagreements in their relationship, but there was no sense that you had to censor yourself, right? I mean, I know my parents growing up were very diametrically opposed on politics.
Oh,
my
really?
Dad was more of like an Ayn Rand libertarian.
Wow.
And my mom was literally a communist. My mom was a Marxist. She was reading Marx and Durkheim to me when I was 5 years old, like indoctrinating
me. All right, that's child
like
abuse.
Fox News' worst nightmare. It was great though. You know, she's
so
giving
he was
me
reading
an education.
Durkheim and Marx to you when you were five.
What, absolutely.
Like, was it like
that's how you
socialist baby?
Like him.
Was yeah, it no,
like,
it was literally like
was
communist baby.
Book?
It was like communist baby.
Did it rhyme? I mean, like, were the pictures?
No, she was reading me like out of Das Kapital. I didn't know.
Okay, this explains everything.
I still don't
everything.
Understand.
Yeah,
Das Kapital.
I think I understand. Yeah.
Okay, are you? Like, did you do you have siblings?
Yeah, I have two sisters. Yeah.
And are they like this? Or are you just a freak in the earth? For like, are they into like, this stuff too? Are they like, are they heterodox?
No. I mean, one is sort of democratic socialist, I would say, like AOC broadly. And the other is kind of difficult to pin down.
Hmm. Are you the oldest?
No, I'm the youngest.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. So one of the things, so Sarah and I were talking about this. So one of the things we wanted to ask you is sort of like, what is your heterodox origin story? Because I feel like everybody has something that kind of led them to thinking in a more counterintuitive way or anything like that. And you actually, I want to let you take this, but I heard an interview with you where you were talking about something and I was like, that's what it is. And so you can answer and then I'll tell you what I think it is.
I'll tell you if it's the same thing I said that. It's funny. I wonder if my story will be different because sometimes on different days you write a different
narrative. Well, you didn't say it was your origin story,
but you
said something about your life and I thought that's why he is the way he is.
So I think I would say two factors seem significant to me. One is I grew up in a very racially diverse town where I had friends of every race and I did not think of them as belonging to a race. And I naturally rebelled against the significance, I think, given to race later in life as a result of growing up in that way. And secondly, I think as a teenager, my main passion was music and jazz in particular, which is extremely racially diverse, and we're kind of like the army or something. You end up becoming extremely close friends with people of very different races and even other parts of the world. And that background being like my whole life, then being thrust into like a post 2014 Great Awakening era hotbed of wokeism at Columbia, and all these people telling me like I'm a victim, racism is everywhere. It was a level of concern about racism that was greater than what I experienced from my Black family that grew up in Jim Crow. Like kids would be talking more pessimistically about society than my grandparents, and something seemed just like that like broke me. I just had to understand what is going on here, because it was just an insane phenomenon. So you were an undergraduate around this time,
2014?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Okay. That answers part of the question.
Okay. What was your...
Okay. Well, I'd be curious. Okay. I don't want to...
I was also bitten by a spider when I was 16.
Really?
No, that's my
origin story. Yeah. I was bitten by a vampire myself. No, I heard you talk, and I can't remember where this was. So your mom passed away, right? Mm-hmm. You lost mm-hmm. your mom to mm-hmm. cancer when mm-hmm. you were a teenager?
18, yeah.
Okay. I heard you talking about how she was like relying on alternative medicine a lot. Mm-hmm. And I don't know what the situation was, but like I was listening to you talk and I thought, and you sounded like a little bit like you were frustrated that she had maybe over relied on that or not gotten the sort of, you know, Western modern treatment that might have helped her. And I thought, I wonder if that is what is informing a lot of the like allergy to bullshit.
I think that's right. I mean, that's an aspect I often don't think about because it's painful, but
yeah.
Yes, my mom got very deeply into alternative medicine probably around 2010. She got cancer and then went into remission, and then she started getting deeply into alternative medicine, especially Ayurvedic medicine, which is ancient Indian medicine. And it was really like her main passion in life, and she got kind of deeper and deeper into it and more radicalized to the point where she changed her main doctor to this guy who still has a practice in New York, actually, Dr. Ali, who has like very bizarre theories about he believes like all chronic diseases have the same cause, which is like lack of oxygen metabolism in the cells, and it can be solved by like deep breathing, like anything from like lupus to cancer to diabetes, like all of these have one cause. And so she got deeply into this guy, and this guy did not believe in scans, in typical kinds of scans. And so he didn't run any tests on her, right? And and as a result, her cancer came back, you know, long before she detected it. And at that point, it spread to her skeleton, and she only detected it because, the way I remember it at least, is because she said she was in pain, and I told her to go to a chiropractor because it worked for my friend. Chiropractor did the normal scans any Western medical doctor would have done and found cancer all over her body, right? Where she had been going to this guy for years. And at the end of her life, she felt bitter and in some sense betrayed that she could have lived longer had had this guy been better. And so I do blame that for her premature death. Who knows how long she would have lived otherwise, but I definitely blame the uncritical hatred of, you know, Western science, Western scientific institutions, and all the rest for that. So and I also feel there's a really strong value in just insisting on the truth. and all of that. So I think that's definitely part of it.
Yeah, because it seems to me like, you know, we all sort of have our areas, whether it's race or gender or free speech, like sort of, you know, free thinking movement has free thinking kind of ecosystem has many sort of like subsets of interest. But ultimately, it's about hating bullshit.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, no matter what your particular bugaboo is.
Especially good sounding bullshit.
yeah.
For years, I could not bring myself to actually look at that doctor. I couldn't bring myself for years to look into his philosophy and of the guy that was medicating my mom for years. And then sometime a year or two ago, I couldn't sleep one night for some reason. And I watched like 100 of his Vimeo lectures to understand his philosophy. And it was very difficult, the thought that my mother had been duped by this guy, mm-hmm. and that had cost her potentially years of her life. Mm. And this guy he's a very kind of charismatic critic of Western medicine. And I see how, especially someone who's had trouble with the medical system, which is like a lot of people, because mm-hmm. there are so many problems actually with our medical system. Someone who had bad experiences, horrible doctors, surgical errors, all kinds of crazy stuff can go to that extreme. But it nevertheless is extremely dangerous. And I definitely think that's a part of my origin story.
Did you ever reach out to him or like say, I mean, I would have.
I have so much bile for this person. Yeah. I don't think that I want to. I don't know that engage I could engage with him without wanting to destroy him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Wow.
That's hard.
No, I was surrounded by like pseudoscience stuff, but it wasn't, you know, I guess maybe it's like a South Asian thing or like a non-Western thing, but you know, in Pakistan at least, and I think also like in India, it's like there's a fusion of all kinds of different ideologies and people aren't thinking clearly enough to be like, this contradicts this, you know? So mm. you go to, you know, homeopathy, and you go to that kind of doctor and they give you some sugar pills, and you go mm-hmm. to a Western doctor maybe if you have the money, and then you take, you know, you see what they have to say and take whatever they have to give you. I don't know if like my parents ever saw it as necessarily something that contradicted in their minds, mm-hmm. but I remember always having all these like little sugar pills, like, you know, like those, I don't know if you
really
because
it was so sugar pills.
Well, yeah, they're just sugar pills, that's all they are, that's all,
like, that your parents gave you or that you would get from a doctor when you they took you to a doctor?
Both. Like, they knew doctors who practice like homeopathy in Pakistan and also in the United States. They found like people who could do that. And I remember, you know, I was sick and they would give me these things and they tasted really good. And I actually loved that medicine. So I would like pretend to be like, I'm like, some sick, I need
Smarties.
Yeah. It was like candy. And I remember one time I woke up in the middle of the night. My cousin was over. She was taller. And I had her. I was like, let's go get some medicine. And we we went to the cabinet. She held me on her shoulders. We got like a big thing of medicine and like gorged on it. And nothing
happened.
You
didn't think you were going to have an overdose?
I was like four or five. Like, I was like a kid. And she was like not much older than me. And so obviously we're just kids, you're going into the medicine cabinet and nothing happened. And years later I heard, you know, the phrase like the dose makes the poison. And I remember thinking, why wasn't that poisoned? Like, why did nothing happen to me? Like, oh, okay, because there's no dose. There's no, it's not medicine. Nothing,
right.
Nothing there is working at all on any level.
So did your parents know that they were sugar pills?
No.
They were marketed as...
They didn't think about it.
Something else.
They call them doctors.
Placebo.
So it's like doctor whatever, you know, like who, you know, our local like doctor.
Right.
So in addition to the Western doctor, so they have Western doctors, but Western doctors are expensive. Mm-hmm. Like those kinds of medical doctors are expensive, you know, both here and there. So this was like another alternative, and you see what they have to say and you take, and it can't hurt. That's how they approached it.
And it's amazing the power of placebo and mm-hmm. nocebo, and just the power of suggestibility mm-hmm. in everyday life. It's just, it's incredible. Like sometimes I think I have a a bit of a complex about whether I get enough sleep. Mm-hmm. So like if I get, I only got like 4 hours of sleep last night.
Me too.
And usually I feel fine right now, but usually when that happens, I'm just in my head all day about, oh, I'm not going to be at my best for this podcast, you know, with Sarah and Meghan. I only, why did I stay yeah, up?
How
why
dare
did
I, you? You only got 4 hours of sleep
exactly,
for us?
You know, why did I not plan better so I got everything done, blah, blah, blah. But that very line of thinking is part of what makes me feel bad, right? Like if you could somehow do an experiment where I have no idea how much sleep I got last night, I'm not sure I would detect feeling bad at all. I'd probably feel absolutely fine.
I think pain has a lot. Pain is related to that as well, just like your mindset in a lot of ways. All these chronic illnesses that people have, like long COVID. I don't want to get in trouble. Like, maybe it's real. But there are so many like psychosomatic illnesses that become fads, and people adopt them and think, and they begin to rule their lives, and they begin to define themselves by this chronic illness that they have, the doctors can't pin down, and you know, they don't know the real cause. They don't know what's happening here, and it just happens to be that people with anxiety disorders, like people who are generally of the nervous temperament, are the kinds of people who gravitate towards having.
They over-index for other ailments.
Which is that's so interesting, because to me, I mean, there is like. So there is a biological component at some point, you know, like there's some kind of person, you know, through their, you know, genetic materials or whatever, is predisposed to be highly suggestible or like, you know, nervous. That's what they used to call them, nervous, nervous disorders. And now they have all these chronic illnesses. And it's amazing. Like their community.
Did you guys see Ross Douthat's, who's a great, my favorite New York Times
he's
columnist.
My favorite too.
I think he's the best.
He's a fantastic writer.
Yeah. So did you see his, I think it was both a column and a book about his having long Lyme.
I didn't read it, but it's apparently really, really excellent.
It was very compelling because I agree with everything you just said about, like, you know, the suggestibility of, and I'm also skeptical of, you know, how many people who think they have long COVID really have long COVID, as opposed to you feel shitty and tired for the normal reasons, and you saw that on the news, and now that's the thing you blame. That's a real phenomenon. But Ross Douthat wrote about how he started, you know, in middle age having these, this cluster of shitty symptoms, which is just like all the shitty symptoms you can have. And he would go to doctors, and many doctors would like doubt that it was a real thing, because I think it is somewhat controversial whether long Lyme disease is a real illness or a psychosomatic illness, and the difference between those two may be somehow conceptually not unimportant, right? Because if you can think your way into really feeling bad, then doesn't matter. And what's interesting about it is that Ross is a very rational guy, I would say, other than his probably commitment to Christianity,
Catholicism. And
God. Yeah, other than his extreme. I know that sounds funny. Other than the fact that he murders a lot of guys, that's a very nice guy.
No. He eats rosemary focaccia, baby. Baby flatbreads. Yeah, but no, he is. He's not the usual suspect for this kind of thing.
That's exactly what I mean.
Yeah.
So the fact that he was really on the side of, you know, take people's illnesses seriously because, and don't dismiss them as psychosomatic, was a very interesting angle for me, and kind of pushed my views around. On it. And he had even tried strange things like light therapy or sound therapy, kind of like woo stuff, and some of it worked, or one crucial thing actually reduced his pain. And at the end of the day, if you have pain for whatever reason and you do X and pain goes away, you're going to keep doing X, no matter how scientifically grounded you are. I don't care if you read 10 peer review studies saying light therapy doesn't work. If it makes the pain in my lower back go away, I'm in there.
So
it's an interesting conversation.
I think the Lyme disease, I tend to be more, I believe that more than other things. I mean, I certainly, I know many people who've struggled with that, and they're not necessarily people that
it could
would
be. I mean, it could be a bit of both too, because there's something that happens like conceptually when you like, let's say you have like a tingle here and like, you know, problem here. And then you look it up and then you find out that there's a name, you know, like there's a condition and there's all these other symptoms. And then you think, huh, you know what? I am also feeling this and this and this. And I think, you know, I don't want it I don't want it to come across like these people are stupid, because not only do I think that I could fall for this, like I know that I have fallen for this, you know, to see a list of things that kind of match in my brain, which is like this pattern matching machine is sitting there. I have this. Mm-hmm. Now I feel all the other symptoms too. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, and I think that there's something about the mind-body connection there, which not to sound woo, that sounds woo, mind-body connection.
Yeah, we're going to bleep that
like,
out.
Clearly, please. There's something, clearly something's going on that we can suggest ourselves into feeling really, really terrible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, and vice versa. You can suggest yourself into feeling amazing.
Yeah. When you're.
And when you're around people that feel amazing and it's contagious, like emotions and states of being are contagious at some level.
Yeah. I once read like this article, it was like going around like my Twitter circles was this guy who was like, actually, you don't need a lot of sleep. It's all BS. And you only need to eat. I lived on like 4 hours of sleep for like this amount of time. And he like logged it and he wrote about it and it was very compelling and he was a smart person.
Therefore, that's true for everyone.
And well, you know, I read that and I remember like for a few days afterwards, like even when on the days where I got 4 hours of sleep, I was like, you know what? I'm fine. And well, I felt fine.
Well, what if they came out and said, oh, you know what? The research is now showing that nobody needs more than 4 hours of sleep. Like, this has all been this has been incorrect. Mm-hmm. And going forward, this is all you need. I bet people would get used to it.
I think a surprising number of people might. Although that 4 hours of sleep thing, if Matthew Walker, that sleep expert guy that wrote that big book a few years ago, if he's right, there's just a certain gene that governs that, and certain people just have the super sleep gene, where they feel as good on four as the rest of us feel on eight.
Yeah.
And are those people like, you know, tech billionaires and probably CEOs? Those are
but they're productive,
or they're
like,
up in their mother's basements playing Call of Duty until 5
the whole night. My husband's like that. He's like a super, he can survive on like 5 hours, good, he's good. I could sleep for 10 if you let me. If nobody woke me up and I had nothing to do, I could sleep
too.
For 10.
Me too. But this gets into like the social contagion issue, which touches on trans and gender dysphoria, but is also just in its own right one of the most interesting phenomena.
Well, we don't talk about that.
You don't talk about that.
We don't talk about trans.
Yeah, no, I've heard you don't do. Yeah, no. I know. I heard that's the one topic you avoid.
We're not just not interested in it.
Yeah. So I don't want to drive you in there.
No.
But no, like there are, what's interesting to me is like, forget the topic of gender dysphoria for a moment and just think about social contagion in general. There are these fascinating cases where a whole, you know, school develops, say, like hiccups.
Yeah.
Or Tourette's.
Or Tourette's.
There was a case, there's been several cases.
Yeah, TikTok Tourette's, where suddenly there's a spike in Tourette's. Doctors all over the country saying, what the hell is going on? Is it something that's in the water? Is it something? And the only thing that explains it is all the new cases of Tourette's have TikToks and follow influencers who have Tourette's. And I've seen some of these influencers. It's actually very interesting content for someone to let you into their Tourette's tick. Mm. But then it becomes this status thing of like, they're cool because they have this tick. And oh, like maybe I sometimes stutter. Maybe that's like, and then it develops into a thing. And people fixate on it, and there may even be an autism component too, where people more likely to fixate because they have ASPIH or autistic tendencies can go deeper down certain rabbit holes and ways of being, and are less flexible and maybe take things more literally, And so you see that, you know, like hiccups outbreak at some school. I think it was Massachusetts or something.
Hiccups? Is there a hiccup TikTok?
There was a hiccups.
But is there a hiccup influencer community?
I don't know if they've done
a
collab. No, I don't think hiccups and TikTok have linked up. Okay. But there was a hiccups outbreak at a school, at one school. It was either Massachusetts or Delaware, I forget. And they were literally looking at, is it something in the water supply in the town? Is it something?
Yeah.
And it was just a kind of spontaneous emergent phenomenon and for some reason they tend to hit young women the worst, more than young men and more than adults in general.
Yeah.
So when you take that background and then you look at the facts, which I know you've, you know, talked about on your podcast, of the wild spike in the number of natal female identifying as gender dysphoric as opposed to natal males, which have gone up a little, but
it's
not gone.
I see more and more natal males in this.
But I remember seeing, like, at least in, I think it was the American Plastic Surgery Association. This is from Abigail Schreier's book. But I checked it and it seemed legit, which was that there was like a 400% spike in natal female.
4,000.
4,000.
Really? 4, there was, spike? I've heard four. Well, I think there was data out of the UK, maybe Tavistock. 4,000% increase in natal females going to gender clinics.
Yeah,
that's some form of dysphoria. But I mean, dysphoria is a very broad term, so that could mean any number of things. But yeah,
right. So there was a single year where there was like a fourfold difference in the increase for natal females as opposed to natal males, which is interesting because if the theory is we're all just becoming less bigoted against trans people, so trans people are coming out of the closet essentially, that would seem to affect both genders equally, yet there's this huge disparity, which definitely lends itself to a social contagion
element. Like, even if there isn't, if that's not the whole explanation, there's definitely an element. And that's a good, like, almost an axiom that anytime you see a wild, like, an explosion of young women participating in anything, especially if it's like a medical thing, or, you know, it somehow distinguishes themselves from everyone else, maybe start thinking about it as social in some form.
Because it's women. But is there some personality trait, like women are higher in, like, what are those categories? Like, there's like neuroticism and all these, what do they call, like, the big five traits or something?
Yeah, the big five personality
traits.
So
is there one of those traits that are like, make women more susceptible, or are we more?
I think we're just social thinkers.
Is it empathy? Because we're like absorbing, sort of emotionally absorbent.
Empathy, yeah, because if you're actually feeling what the people around you are feeling, then conditions can spread, right? Psychological conditions can literally spread.
Right. Yeah. That's Sarah. Thank God Sarah and I don't have any empathy. We wouldn't be here. I feel so, like, not female in this sense.
In the empathy sense?
You're just 100%. I would never be, like, I see something like that and it makes me less interested in having anything to do with it.
Mm. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm sympathetic to a lot of people. Like, I'm a sympathetic person. I can, you know, like, I have compassion for other people, but I don't absorb their feelings.
Well, let me turn that question back on you. What are your heterodox origin stories? Like, what do you attribute it to in each of your cases?
Well, we know Sarah's.
Yeah.
Because she was
I don't know, she was a
religious fundamentalist.
I wasn't a religious fundamentalist. I was like,
what?
Yeah, what? But yeah.
She was
I was a religious person.
Yeah.
Like, religious. Yeah.
At what age?
I started questioning religion when I was 15. Mm-hmm. And I left, like, soon after. Mm-hmm. Like, it didn't take long at all. Mm. But I had been thinking, like, a thinking person, thinking deeply about, you know, values and, but most importantly, like, what's true in the world, you know, and, like, how can we know it? Mm-hmm. And the arguments that worked really well for me and there was no going back where, you know, some of, like, the logical contradictions of Abrahamic belief specifically. Mm-hmm. And then I left Islam. Well, I left religion. I stopped believing in God and then I stopped believing in Islam as a consequence. And, you know, because a lot of women, they talk a lot about women's issues when it comes to Islam, right? Mm-hmm. When it comes to gender problems, hijab and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. But for me, like, I'm such a, I don't know, jihadist at heart, but it's like, for me, it's like, here's what I mean by that. But I mean that if the Quran is true, then the moral, you know, universe, like, that the Quran inhabits, like, that's true. We have to accept that even if we don't understand it, even if it seems like oppression, we don't know. Mm. God knows by definition. Mm. So we have to accept the morality as well, like, that the Quran comes with. So for me, I had no problem, like, kind of just accepting it if I thought the objective claims were true.
Right.
Once I started doubting those, everything else fell apart very quickly. Then it was an easy thing to just like sort of give up. But that, I think I was always a skeptical person, like always. And I think in one way or another, I would have ended up here. Mm-hmm. I don't know if there was like a point at which I became the person, you know, like the, without which I wouldn't have been here. I think I would have been here regardless. Mm-hmm. Maybe I'm just a little bit more extreme.
So I think you and I definitely have in common that cast of mind that would really want to know whether something is actually true and take that to its logical conclusion. And that might just be like personality almost hardwired.
Yeah.
But if there were any aspects of your experience, are there any aspects of your experience that you think explain the fact that you really cared about sharing your way of thinking with the world? Because many people with that cast of mind would say, okay, I'm going to go do finance or whatever. And now I've decided religion's not true. But you took it upon yourself to put yourself out there in a very, especially very heated time for the issue, and a very heated issue, and you know, throw your reputation in a very vulnerable way. What do you think accounted for that?
I don't know if it was any, you know, specific experience, but I, you know, I grew up in Pakistan, like somewhat, like we were better off there. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, I went to a nice school, I had nice things, and, you know, I came to the United States and we had nothing all of a sudden, because my parents came when they were older. They didn't speak very good English, so their skills were not transferable. Mm-hmm. You know, of course, without understanding the language or the social atmosphere, you really have a tough time getting back to the same place that you were when, you know, where you started from. And so I was catapulted into, like, I don't want to, because it wasn't poverty, but it was definitely lower income America. Mm. And starting to see how people lived. The first kind of campaign, I guess, of injustice that you know I took on internally was class based. You know, because I remember seeing my neighbors. I remember seeing how the kind of invisible ways that they were getting tripped up, and how unfair it seemed that my friends who had a lot of money were deaf and not necessarily more ability or anything else or more talent, innate skill or even intelligence, but that they were definitely going to do better because they were set up in all these like important ways. Mm-hmm. So I think I became kind of a social justice warrior, but like, you know, like, but in terms of class. Yeah. And I remember wanting to become a lawyer and work with like these like lower income people and immigrants and all this. And it was like really important to me to be somebody who made a change in the world. And my atheism only increased that feeling because then it was like, oh, there's only ever this life. So if we don't have justice here, we're not going to have it anywhere else. There is no like heaven to make it all better and to make your sufferings here meaningful. Mm-hmm. So we have to try and make things better here.
Mm. Oh, wow. That's so interesting. So like there's no second act.
No.
So is that why you like didn't go to law school, for instance? You just like, I have one chance. I'm going to do this. I mean, you could still go to law school.
I could still go to law school.
The podcasting thing. You know,
it was just, you know... I don't know if I have like so much of a plan in life as in, you know, in any given moment, a different conception, not entirely different, but maybe a different conception of what's the lever that I can pull that will make the biggest, what's the one lever that I can pull that will make the biggest difference. And there was a point where that was law school. And then there was a point where it's, okay, no, I can start this nonprofit organization and I can make a big difference here. And now it's a podcast.
Definitely. I mean, we're difference makers. That's why we're doing this.
We're heroes.
We want to help the poor.
Are we heroes?
I think so.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Martyrs. I consider myself a martyr from doing this.
Did you see in Prince Harry's memoir, there's a passage where he was doing something and he said... And then someone used the word hero to describe me.
No.
And I would have none of it.
No.
You read Prince Harry's memoir?
No, I just saw an excerpt. I thought to myself, what a disingenuous. Really, if you really had none of it,
I would have,
you wouldn't have put it in.
But I need to tell
anymore.
You, it's like I give anonymously.
Yeah.
I would
of
like you to know. I'm an anonymous donor.
People have said yeah. about you, you cherry picked this one and said, oh, but I would have none of it. But you have to put it in your book.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah.
What's your origin story?
You know, it's so I really think it comes down to this hyper awareness of fakery and affectation. And I sort of was hyper aware of virtue signaling before there was a term for it. Mm. So my family is very interesting, actually. So I come from a family of musicians.
Oh, cool.
And my father was a trombone player, actually.
No way. Wow.
Yeah.
Jazz or classical?
Yeah, jazz.
Yeah, nice.
There's not a lot of classical trombone, I guess. I mean, there's not.
A symphony orchestra.
Great symphony,
sure,
yes. When did the trombone actually come into existence?
It was originally called the sack butt. Don't laugh.
The sack butt.
Yes, the sack butt, which is a German word. I said don't laugh. It's the history of my instrument.
I can't
Sarah.
Believe that didn't take off. That should be the name of your podcast.
Yeah,
the sack butt,
the sack
with butt Coleman podcast. Hughes.
And it was a. I think I want to say the 17th or 18th century.
Oh, okay.
So it's an old instrument. I think it's older than the trumpet. It's such a simple instrument.
Yes.
It's much older than the saxophone, and even a
oh,
little
the
bit,
saxophone is yeah. pretty new. Yeah.
Yeah. So, But so I mean, yeah, trombone is in every symphony.
Okay,
most symphony
because it's not like a
pieces.
Baroque instrument, though. For instance,
it was. I think what era would the Baroque?
Well,
era
the Baroque
be?
Would be. I mean, like Bach, Handel. I mean, there because there were brass instruments in that time, but you don't see.
Yeah.
Maybe the trombone was just sort of configured. Obviously, it was must have been configured differently.
Yeah, I don't know if it was relevant in that time.
Right.
Yeah.
So I was an oboist anyway. So,
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because there's Baroque oboe, which is mm-hmm. its own slightly. Different version. Anyway, but what's that?
Beautiful instrument.
thanks. It's not the bassoon,
when
by the way.
Well.
I
when
know
played
you,
well.
When played well. Yes. Yeah. One of my very early pieces when I published in my 20s was this essay called Music is My Bag. Mm. And it was about the kind of culture of band people and like scholastic musicians.
Yeah.
And the way like in my day, there would always be the kid that had like the scarf, the piano key scarf, like the black and white
yeah.
piano key scarf.
Mm.
And you would like walk into the band room and the kid would always be playing Billy Joel on the piano, like the beginning of Angry Young Man. Like there were just, this was of in my time. So, but actually this does speak to your question because I, for a variety of reasons, was totally obsessed with the space between like, what actually existed and what people were pretending existed mm-hmm. and like what people actually were and what they were sort of trying to be. So not my dad so much. I mean, my dad was a very eccentric person, very contrarian, very critical, would just was totally unfiltered. Mm-hmm. Like we would be going to there was this French restaurant that he loved to go to and in New York. And there was often a piano player, like a guy playing piano in the restaurant. And one time we went there and it was a different guy. It was a substitute piano player. Mm-hmm. And we were walking out of the restaurant and my father literally goes up to the guy. And he's like, you know, you're not a very good player. Like, where's Ralph? Because like, I don't know what you're doing here. Like my father would routinely behave that way.
Real life okay. Larry David.
Was he yeah. autistic or was?
Yes, I'm sure okay. he was like a fairly high functioning autistic, but he was so insanely almost savant-like about music. He was an orchestrator and he was an arranger. Mm. And so he was incredibly good technician and could hear anything. Like, we'd sit down and read a musical score and actually be able to hear it in his head.
Mm.
So he had this like kind of weird, quirky, eccentric, but like very deep kind of aesthetic life. And my mother, on the other hand, my parents had met. They're from Southern Illinois, which is like really, that is sack butt USA. That is like butt USA. Okay. And they were very conscious. My mother especially was very conscious of striving and getting out of that kind of cultural sphere. And she sort of attached herself, not myself, to my father. who was using like academic channels to try to ascend. So he had been, he actually ran the jazz band at the University of Texas when I was a kid. And
that's kind of a famously good band.
And he was like made no friends and didn't get tenure because he couldn't play. He couldn't get along with everybody. He couldn't play with others. But my mother was just, then we moved to New Jersey, and she was just absolutely obsessed with coming across as if we were incredibly sophisticated, wealthier than we were, because we were not at all. I mean, my father, he flunked out of academia, and then with no job whatsoever, we like got a moving truck and drove to New Jersey so he could like somehow make it as a musician in New York. It was extremely ambiguous. And my mother just was like really put on a lot of airs. And so as her children, our job was to sort of go along with it. And so I think that there was just, I'm very aware of myself as a teenager of like pretending as if, like acting like a child. Like I wasn't even a child. I was playing the role of a child. I wasn't a teenager, but I was performing. I sound like Judith Butler. I performed adolescence. So a lot of it, I think that a lot of my, where I ended up landing was I'm just constantly observing people's behavior and thinking that they're phony, which I think is actually, I'm not right about it all the time. Like most people probably are just being themselves. But by the time the kind of extreme social justice virtue signaling rolled around, I was so massively allergic to it that I couldn't help but speak out about it. But the fact is that, I mean, I've been a professional writer for 30 years, and I've been writing about this stuff and observing this stuff for decades. Like nothing has really changed. But what's interesting is that, like, when I started off as a writer, I was saying all the things that I say now, but it was praised back then, and you were writing for mainstream magazines, and editors loved you, and that was the job. And now it's the opposite of it. Like, now all those publications that embrace me for saying these things, I'm persona non grata.
So you have, like, who's the main character of Catcher in the Rye?
Oh, Holden Caulfield. Everybody's a phony. Yeah.
You have a little Holden Caulfield.
Yeah. I mean, although I feel like that character, it's Salinger is making fun of that kind of person. Like there is a phoniness to Holden's awareness of phoniness.
So. I mean, it's a blurry line, right? Like there's people who are deliberately putting on airs. And they have to be one, like, manipulative enough, socially intelligent enough to notice that there's a way, proper way to behave that's going to elevate me to this next level, and willing to be kind of dishonest enough to sort of put it on. So there's that like pure phony, maybe a narcissist, you know, like those kinds of people, like who are very manipulative, like socially.
Well, that's like a sociopath at some point. Yeah.
Right. So there's that. And then there's like all these shades of gray in between where people pick up, you know, as we were talking about, like where people pick up ideas from the air, you know, they absorb them through their skin and then begin to behave in ways that are not, you know, them, like quote unquote them, like who they really are. Without even recognizing that that's what's happening. I think that's what's so bizarre and creepy about like the present moment.
Yeah. I became a writer because I wanted to say what I actually thought. It was an expression of authenticity.
Yeah.
That was the absolute essence of the job and the only reason that it interested me. And so it's just maddening and extraordinary that we've come to this point where it's like the opposite of the job. In a lot of people's minds.
Yeah. And that it speaks to like a moral like correctness, like to be the kind of person who is good enough to see things for what they are and then say, no, here's how they should be in a, you know, in this perfect social justice world. I find it, I don't know, like it's frightening. It's disheartening. Like, to me, because I'm a very like, I'm a sincere person because I'm autistic, not because I'm like
I thought
I'm
you
so
weren't
good.
Autistic.
Like,
so, you said you weren't.
I'm autistic-ish.
You keep changing your.
No. Because it's a spectrum.
I know, but I said the other day on the podcast, do you think you're autistic? And you said no.
Not in a way that a psychologist would be like, yeah, she's autistic. But there's autistic traits I found. I read up a lot about this.
I think I have some autistic traits too. Yeah. I'm not.
I would say so too. I mean, so I remember someone DM'd me on Twitter and said, I think you're autistic. I'm very autistic. I think you're autistic.
Are you autistic?
Take this test.
Uh-huh.
And I took the test.
An online test?
Yeah. Which,
like, multiple choice? Yeah.
I don't remember. It was some long test. And I came out to be roughly like as close as you could get without being classified that
way.
That's
perfect.
That's a good sweet way to spot, be, I guess. Yeah.
I think so. Because I have no trouble. I have no trouble with the things autistic people typically have trouble with, like reading faces. I have no trouble understanding what someone's feeling and all of that. I've never found that to be difficult.
I occasionally have trouble with that, I feel like. I occasionally have trouble intuiting other people's mindsets.
Yeah.
You know, and sometimes I struggle with that. And I have to have somebody explain to me, like, what's actually going on.
Mm-hmm.
But mostly I can get. But, like,
what would be an example?
What
that someone has to explain to you what's going on?
No. I mean, in specific scenarios, like, let's say a big drama is going on among friends, you know, and people are fighting, and I don't understand what's going on. Why are they fighting? Why are they behaving this way? And then my husband will, like, kindly explain to me, like, what's going on.
He'll mansplain to you.
Yeah, because it's not always 100% intuitive.
Right.
But, you know, I really related to what I heard Robin Hanson. Do you know of who he is?
Yeah, absolutely.
He's like the elephant in the brain guy. He wrote this book.
Great book.
Yeah, great book.
That you would like as a hatred of phoniness. It's basically deep exploration of phoniness in every aspect of
It's like human phoniness, like it's a very
rigorous
so it he is somebody who's like kind of on the spectrum. I don't know if he identifies that way, but he definitely is.
It would not surprise me.
And he was, I remember hearing him talking somewhere, and he was saying that, you know, as somebody who thinks a little differently, he would go into this, like, social world and social situations and not really understand why people were behaving the way they were behaving. Like, clearly there's another element. Like, there's something else. There's invisible strings that are, you know, that he cannot perceive at all because of his, like, difference, like, the, you know, neuroatypicality. And that kind of made him a really interesting, like, social, like, theorist and, like, somebody who would go into this social psychology because it's invisible to you. You have to find a reason and an explanation. And so his, like, very explicit reasons are very different than the reasons we give ourselves when we do certain things, our motivations.
I mean, if you're, like, very not autistic and very effortlessly tapped into social norms, you have no reason to create an explicit model of what social norms are.
Yeah.
Whereas if you're very autistic, like, maybe, I don't want to say that Robin Hanson is for sure, but someone like him, then you will become extremely curious and want to discover the nature of social norms.
Right, that's all you do.
Like physicists want to discover the laws of the universe. And if you're very smart, you can actually come up with an outsider's perspective on the social world in a way that is extremely interesting.
Yeah.
So I don't think that I've ever really suffered like that problem, but I think whatever aspect of autism like can get you to really fixate on logical consistency and not taking certain shibboleths for granted, I think I have some, and that's why maybe some autistic people relate to me. But I've never
are in this space.
Totally.
But what you just described, this very principle, it flies in the face of the standpoint epistemology, right? So like, I think you're absolutely right that you, as an out, if you are an outsider looking at a phenomenon, you are able to diagnose various aspects of it. You can see it more clearly. And yet we have this whole school of thought that says you're not allowed to speak to anything unless you are part of the group.
Right.
That you are speaking about. Yeah. So ask, you know, what, ask trans people about trans and stop right there.
Right.
I mean, is that not sort of like we should only ask cancer patients about how to about how to treat cancer. I'm not comparing trans to cancer. That's right. I'm not. But like, it just seems we're in this bizarre moment where there's an obsession with being an outsider.
Yeah.
And yet you're not allowed to comment about anything if you are an outsider.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, it's fascinating. I think one analogy a friend made to me that always stuck with me was that people who grew up during the Great Depression and really lived that poverty and unemployment and crisis, often later in life, they would just keep their money in mattresses to their own detriment.
Oh, yeah.
Losing money to inflation, yeah.
Oh,
et cetera.
My grandparents' generation, absolutely.
So it's like their lived experience of living that actually gave them a distorted view of what they should be doing later in life, right? Because of and that goes to your point of, yes, the lived experience of being in a group, it can give you way more like tangible knowledge of like what it is to be in that group. But if you are unable to kind of apply an external lens, you may also be missing a lot.
Limiting belief.
So you get to really learn about stuff, like you want to incorporate the external smart view and the internal lived view.
I feel like we should bring back like old school, like anthropology, you know, but
like,
you know,
going to a place,
there is something,
but like for like
hide in the bushes
America.
And take notes in a notebook
like going to Williamsburg, like doing ethnographic interviews of the hipsters.
Yeah.
The hipsters believe that if you...
Oh, I thought you meant Colonial Williamsburg, but yes. No. They should they should rename Williamsburg, Brooklyn, Colonial Williamsburg, I think.
Yeah, because, so there is like to steel man, I guess, the opposition. There is something about being in a particular environment that exposes you to information that otherwise would be less visible, you know? So it's not invisible, but obviously less visible. So I get that, you know, I totally get that. And I run into that a lot when I talk about class issues, because now I'm in this social environment where like I don't know anybody who, you know, qualifies as like a lower income American, you know, and they're like extremely highly educated people, like at the tippy top of American society. And sometimes when we talk about specific like economic issues or class-based issues, there are whole like realms that are invisible to them that they don't see because they're not familiar with these people. They don't see that their day-to-day lives and you know the kinds of things that they deal with, and it comes across and it shows, you know, like even when we were having the conversation a couple weeks ago about why, you know, like poor people having kids and like rich people we had that conversation. That led me to having another conversation with somebody else about the same thing. And she was just like, well, I don't, you know, poor people, like, you know, how can they afford more kids? Like, there's all this like time that has to go into it. And I was like, but poor people have tons of time. And she was like, well, what do you mean? And I was like, you can't, when you're actually, actually poor, you have nothing you can do on a Saturday besides like the free stuff, like go to the park, like you're a family, you know, you go to the park, you go to a free museum, you go to the public pool that's free, you know, you go to the library, that's it. You know, me, my friends, we go to vineyards, we go to whatever new restaurant and try it out. Like there are options on a Saturday that somebody who is like low income, like really legitimately doesn't have. You wouldn't know that until you were really like as an anthropologist, like becoming one of them, becoming a native, you know, living their life truly. But having said all that, I think it is important to have that anthropologist that has like that distance, emotional distance, especially that distance from like the symbolic meanings that a culture develops over time and accepts. And you don't know those symbolic meanings. You don't, those cultural meanings, you haven't adopted them. You can create new ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. That's why I remember one of the early blog posts that I wrote sort of before I really started writing for Quillette years ago was explaining affirmative action to a Martian, because I just thought it's an interesting and useful exercise to explain something to a fictional being that has zero social context and takes nothing for granted except for logic.
Yeah.
And it's also hilarious. It's just like a very funny premise to do in any situation, and maybe at some level the sweet spot is to be someone that is from within a culture but has just enough of the autistic mode of thinking that they can adopt the external view, because then you sort of get a bit of the benefit of both worlds. You get like, I know enough about this culture from having lived in it for 20 years, but I can also step back and observe it as if from afar.
Mm-hmm.
At least that may account for like, you with Islam and me with American political blackness in some way, may account for our success as observers and critics.
Do you ever think about just how much of people's worldviews are shaped just by their own particular experience? I feel like the majority of kind of arguments I get into with people, it's because they are objecting to something that somebody said because it doesn't align with their very personal experience. And I'm totally guilty of this too.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, it's impossible to get around. Like, we've talked about the having kids thing. Like, we've talked about, like, you know, should you, is it, are people not having big families because of X, Y, or Z?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then the amount of people who write to me, and I'm sure to you, and say, well, that's not true because I have this, or my, this, the anecdotal evidence is so overwhelming to many people. But I think I'm guilty of it too.
Like, everybody's guilty of
it. Make all sorts of sweeping generalizations about people's social lives or, you know, how they want to live.
It helps to be able to, like, I think the way that you can crawl out of that, the one, or not entirely, but maybe there's a path out, is to look at the numbers of the things, you know, look at how people actually behave, which is like, think like an economist.
Like, look at the data.
You know, like, think like an economist, and what does that tell you? Like, how do people actually behave? That kind of, like, behavioralist, economic analysis is very, very fascinating to me. And it's also bizarre because, you know, it makes you feel uncomfortable almost, because it makes you think, like, I don't know my own mind, you know? I have my own reasonings for why I do things, and turns out, like, someone else can predict that I will behave the opposite as to what I think that I will behave.
This is Robin Hanson's book. I mean, that book, The Elephant in the Brain, I can't recommend enough, because in some sense, it is a deeply cynical analysis of human behavior, but it's also accurate in some way, because the basic insight of that book is that we are very good at lying to ourselves. And the reason we are this way is because it's evolutionarily advantageous for animals like ourselves to believe our own bullshit in certain ways.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously what really got our ancestors' genes into the next situation was being high social status, marrying a mate with great genes and also social standing and all the right and all the rest. And almost by definition, our psychology is oriented towards doing this for ourselves. But that's a very selfish motive. So our prefrontal cortex basically acts like a press secretary for the actual operation of our brain, which is like the rest of the White House and the decisions that get made for self-interested, you know, reasons. And then the press secretary, which is your prefrontal cortex, tells your mouth what to say about why you're doing this.
Oh my God. Right?
Everything has a selfless motive. Everything is because I'm just such a great guy and I want to do good in the world. Meanwhile, you can tease out certain differences. Well, if that were true, you'd behave this way, but you're actually behaving as if you were kind of a more self-interested actor. And that's true to a degree that is pretty upsetting and, like I said, could be seen as cynical, but it's nevertheless the case. Like, we're all kind of being press secretaries for ourselves. And again, it's best if you actually believe your own bullshit.
I know,
because most people are not like great liars. So it's much better if you're able to convincingly give your story about why you're doing what you're doing. And even, do you guys know about these split brain experiments?
Yeah. I was about to say that. Yeah, they're wild.
Tell me.
Okay, so this is another way to see this. So they used to do this procedure on patients where they would split the corpus callosum, which is what connects the left brain and the right brain. They would do this, I think, to schizophrenia.
There were some kind of disorder.
Okay, so this was
that could be made better if
okay,
you.
Okay,
if
this
you
wasn't like an experiment
no,
on
no,
humans.
No, no, no. There was
okay.
a problem, and it okay. would be solved by this surgery.
Okay,
that's right. And as we know, I think is it the left brain that governs speech, or is the right brain that governs speech?
I think right is
the right,
right
is the
left is more like.
Creativity and okay, so let's just say for the sake of it, doesn't matter.
I think it's reverse, but yeah, okay, yeah. Go ahead.
I think the left is like math.
Yeah, the left is like
right.
Okay, the right is speech.
Because I don't have any left brain at all.
In a very crude way of yeah, I think that's
okay. So let's just say the right governs speech, and the left governs other things, and also the left governs the right eye, and the right governs the left eye. In most of us, this doesn't matter because the two halves of our brains are connected. They can share information. But if you've had that split, then information coming into your right eye actually only goes to your left brain and does not go to your right brain. So people have been able to do experiments where they show these patients with split brain information in only one side of their brain. And so... basically, what would happen in these experiments is they would show one half of the brain, the half of the brain that can't speak, they would show it some image or some piece of information or give it some direction, like get up and go to the bathroom, right? And then the person would get up and go to the bathroom, and the experimenter would ask, why are you going to the bathroom? And the other side of the brain, which was not told to go to the bathroom, would come up with some bullshit reason about why
amazing.
I just got up.
Yeah, it's like amazing.
That the
creepy.
Person totally believes, right? And this is only because you essentially have two people now in the brain, and one of them is coming up with convincing explanations all the time of what the other one is doing. And meanwhile, the person feels like he is saying true things. Now, I mean, so far as I know, none of these people felt bewildered by their own behavior. They just felt like they felt pretty normal.
Yeah.
And the extent to which this is that we are able to do this all the time is like something else is deciding for you to do something and you're coming up with a reason, a post hoc explanation of your behavior afterwards that always paints you as being a coherent and kind and generous and relatable person. It's a very you know, kind of dark and skeptical and somewhat cynical view of human beings, but that I think there's an element of truth to it, no doubt.
So like a more positive perspective of the same thing, mm-hmm. instead of viewing it as necessarily selfish, which I think what Robin Hanson does, which it is mm-hmm. selfish, but it's also just like pro-social, right? Like, 'cause mm-hmm. In order to survive, we're not just engaging with the universe, but we're engaging with each other and each other, like our social environment, that's our best bet for survival, for mm-hmm. like a whole host of things. So it's important to always be, you know, vibing with the group alongside seeing objective reality.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, I think there's so much of these, you know, like class and, you know, like signaling and all this stuff. It's just... pro-social behavior has gone wrong, you know, like gone, like become too deranged.
Well, it's been taken out of a natural environment.
Yeah.
It's been funneled into distorting technology.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That's a lot of it.
So what do you mean by that? Expand on that.
What do you mean?
So like pro-social behavior distorted by tech.
Well, getting along to go along.
Or even recognizing, like, so we monitor our social environment all the time. Mm-hmm. And this is mostly a good thing, you know, and we see what other people think. We hear the different opinions and we, like, take all those different opinions and figure out what we think about it, what we think about it, or what the correct thing to think might be. Mm-hmm. And most of the time, other people are not stupid. In a normal environment, they're like, there's a zebra there, there's a, you know, lion there. Like, that's a good thing to pay attention to. That's a good thing to know. And it's good to pick up that information from your social environment and to constantly be monitoring. But now we have Facebook, which introduces a level of, like, social monitoring that is insane. It's not helpful. It's actually harmful because we are hearing the nitty-gritty political opinions of everybody around us, and we are conforming ourselves to those opinions.
Yeah, and you're not even reacting to reality. You're reacting to a simulacrum of reality. And it's just like a hall of mirrors, and it just more and more degrees removed from
anything
tangible.
Even worse, like
you're
reacting to a slice of reality that's been algorithmically chosen to like engaged to maximize your engagement, which could mean pissing you off the most or confirming what you deeply believe the most. So it's like a deeply biased sample of reality that you're being fed every day.
So there's a crazy, there's something about technology in particular that's deranging our like social instincts in a way that is, it's departing from objective reality in a kind of a frightening way. I think the gender issue is a good example of all of that, but we won't touch it. Or will we? No,
but
it's, you know, it's a frightening thing. At some point, we're going to have to hit reality again, right? At some point, we're going to engage. We're going to go too far, and it's going to become a problem.
Do you think, or is it just going to get worse and worse?
I mean, when it comes to like the gender stuff, what you're starting to see in the UK, in other countries, where they're starting to push back. They're starting to be like, there are actually, this is not this, this like transition is not something, it's an experimental process. We don't know what we're dealing with on the other end, the medical issues involved, the psychological issues involved. So we don't know exactly how effective it is. So they're starting to come back into reality after, only after reality made itself, you know, it presented itself in a form that could not be argued with or like hushed away, you know, because you had piles and piles of young people who were like,
I know, but I wonder if even if on the clinical level, this kind of treatment ceases to be, or at least is not as common, there's still going to be a whole theoretical landscape.
Yeah.
And people are going to dig in even harder, right? It's like, okay, well, maybe I can't get puberty blockers or cross-sex hormones, but that means I'm going to, this is going to be even more constructed.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to take
what
this.
Do you mean
well, like, if, okay, so if transition, if I can't transition because the clinic doesn't offer that anymore, I'm still going to identify as transgender, but I'm going to like dig in all the harder, saying like, transition. I identify, yes, I identify with this, my theoretical self-concept. I'm going to impose that upon the world even harder. So I feel like it could go either way.
To the extent that institutions depart from, like, it cannot be checked by reality, like those institute, especially like humanities, like the aspects of academia, whole fields in academia, that are, that there's no check. At no point does it have to be, does it have to measure itself against.
The building is not going to fall down because the humanities department decides that something is real versus something else.
This is, I think, one of my favorite writers, Thomas Sowell. Listeners to my podcast will not be surprised. One of his books is called Intellectuals and Society. And I think one of the undervalued insights from that book, and others have made it as well, I think Paul Johnson has made this insight too, is that intellectuals and commentators, people like us, don't really pay a personal price for false predictions or for false statements.
No, we're not going to kill anybody.
Yeah.
Probably.
Whereas like any average like food cart owner on the street in New York, a person of much lower status than any of us, who in some sense is valued less by society, pays an extreme price for being wrong about what people want to eat and for changes in the market and for changes in prices, pays an immediate and swift price for error.
Or could poison somebody if their food is not fresh, if they make an error in judgment about what they can serve, they could kill somebody.
That's right.
Yeah.
Whereas the incentives... in some sense, I think incentives are more important than intelligence in terms of getting things right and getting things wrong. Like if you told me I was going to get punched in the face by Conor McGregor every time I got a fact wrong about the world, I mean, I could be much dumber than I am and probably get things right even a higher percentage of the time. Just because of how deeply I would be emotionally tied to getting things right.
Yeah.
But intellectuals, that basically the incentive structure is connected to gaining status, and that has only a very tenuous connection to saying what is true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I actually wrote about this on my Substack, like this almost exact same thing. When it came to, but the topic I was focusing on was lab leak and like how suddenly it's become an okay thing to think. But it sort of veered off into a discussion of the reliability of public intellectuals, like or just like the idea of a public intellectual. You know, I mean, you are performing to some degree. It you can't just say things that are perfectly true. You are incentivized to say things that feel true, that, you know, fit into the framework of your audience and what they expect. Or maybe you push the envelope a little bit. You're edgy, but you can't be too edgy. Like there's a line that you can't go too far, south of, because if you do, then you're a quack. You're not respectable anymore. And suddenly your opinions don't matter. I think that we saw that with COVID. And it was really frustrating to see people who were just discussing, hey, this is a possibility, like the lab leak is a possibility, and for them to be labeled as quacks. And I was one of those people. I remember I was trying to have these kinds of conversations.
Oh, I had.
Yeah.
Oh, well, you were allowed to talk about lab leak for like 3 weeks.
After and the then all of a sudden, it's because it was Tom Cotton. Tom Cotton talked about it as a realistic possibility. He had if you look back to what he said, it was like totally reasonable, you know, completely in line with like reality, actually. But when he said it, he was like a fascist and a racist.
Well,
and whatever,
Trump
and all
said
this,
it. It was
Trump. And so it became untouchable because the wrong people held that opinion. And if you held it, you signaled that you were deranged.
See, I don't.
You know, you were a quack.
See, this deranges yourself. Me because it's like the most. This is Occam's razor, is it not? Yeah. I'm sorry.
No, it totally is. And I think I heard the energy department, which I'm not sure why they haven't.
Yeah, but that's just the energy department, man.
But
who cares?
Well, it's an arm of the government.
I know. But
this is the first real validation at that level.
I know.
Whereas a year ago, I talked about this on my podcast. I think I gave it like a 70 or 80 percent chance of being true, like about a year ago. And I would get some comments and, oh, it's a shame, Coleman, you've gone down the conspiracy.
I had it on my podcast.
Yeah.
2 years ago. Yeah. And it was, people were like, oh my God, you're crazy. What are you?
You're a lurch to the right.
But I find it amazing when people still say they think, a 60% probability. Like, how about 99.9%? But what do I know?
But what they will say now, because you can always justify your stance, like, look back and say, well, back then it wasn't so clear. Back then it was crazy. Now we know so much more.
What has changed? Nothing's changed.
I wonder about that.
Yeah.
I mean, to be honest, I didn't give it any thought until I read that book Viral by
Alina Chan. I had her on my podcast.
Which is, it's been out for over a year. Yeah. It's been out for a while now. And ever since then, I've given it a much higher than 50% chance of being true. And I think, you know, as time goes on, it probably just becomes more and more likely. But, you know, I shouldn't spout off because I don't really know too much about
it. I don't understand the people who say it doesn't matter. That's thing.
That's
a lot of
people say, well, why do you care? Why do you care?
A lot of people said that. I remember that from because when I presented Marshall the evidence, they'd be like, it doesn't matter. You know what matters? Like, people are dying from COVID.
That's absolutely
don't you want to understand where it came from so you understand what it is? It's just mind blowing.
Yeah. Also, to prevent this from happening in the future, right? Like, if it came from wildlife to human directly, that prescribes one whole path of reforms towards preventing the next pandemic, given that so many seem to come from, you know, bats in China and so forth. But if it came from a lab that was doing gain of function research, partly funded by
us, that's the thing, is it's not a xenophobic point. If you want to hate on the U.S. government, this is your baby. Go with it.
Yeah.
It doesn't require conspiracy thinking to see that Fauci actually vocally defended in print, as either New York Times or Washington Post, I forget, in the early 2010s, vocally defended in print gain of function research from other virologists who said, look, this is too dangerous. We should not be intentionally engineering viruses to be more. Fauci said, no, you don't understand. This is crucial, vital research. I know it seems dangerous, but we have to fund it.
You can't say, you can't use that word. You can't say Fauci.
You can't say gain of function either. I said gain of function at a dinner party recently, and they looked at me like, oh, what are you on Fox News? That's the only place I've heard that term used. Yeah. What's going to be next?
Yeah.
Going to deny the Holocaust?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or to conflate that the lab leak is the same thing as a deliberate lab leak.
Exactly. Right. You know,
like, why would they leak it?
No.
Who thinks they
leaked it?
Why
would you deliberately that,
on your own people and your own country?
That is truly conspiratorial.
No, that's bananas.
Yeah, that's bananas. But it was a very interesting sleight of hand to just say, oh, you're saying that. Why would they ever?
So, right. Like, so what you're saying is,
it also makes a serious point about the safety of labs.
Yeah.
So when I was at when I was in college, I was dating a girl who worked in a BSL-3 lab. Mm. BSL-3 is like the security system for labs. And a lot of the research at the Wuhan Institute of Virology was like 3 at the highest, but like even a lot of it actually was done lower.
Yeah.
The state of the BSL-3 lab at Columbia was such that the girl I was dating just like let me in there to like show me around. And it was like,
that's a good
could have done anything. It was like she showed me like the rat, the lab, the mice they worked with.
Yeah.
Let me, like,
she must
I had
have really
no,
liked you.
Gear on or nothing.
No gear on, no nothing. It was just like, it was a total free for all. That's BSL-3, Columbia University, like serious biomedical research happening there. And like things spill out of these places. They're like workplaces, right? It's human error. It's only as secure as the boss of this particular place wants it to be, and it's only as secure as how sleep deprived the worker is that day. And it's amazing that these things weren't taken sufficiently into account by the people who really argued for gain of function research.
Yeah,
it really matters.
I think a lot of politics just like swirls around in a way and becomes like very feverish. That's one of the things that I think is new, that is like technology driven, in that I feel like the narrative of what I'm supposed to think, the correct thing to think, moves very, very fast. Faster than I think that the average person who is not terminally online like us can keep up. You know, they wouldn't know that now you can't say gain of function. Well, you could have said it, 5 months ago, but you can't say it now. Can't even utter it now. I think non-online people live in a kind of a different world, and they're way, way far behind in terms of what the correct thing to think is. And that's just another way that we're seeing this weird bifurcation of this kind of elite social space and like elite people who think in a very particular way, who are speaking to each other in these hyper connected, fast ways. And then you have everybody else who has to go to a job, who can't be on Twitter all day, being like, what is going on? It's so easy in this space to have a political actor that can take advantage of the situation.
In what way?
You know, like to have a smart Trump, you know, imagine if Trump had somebody who had the low, Trump has cunning, you know, he intuitively understands something about like a common man, you know, like
some animal level, some primal level, but he's just disorganized. I mean, our saving grace was it was complete chaotic dysfunction. Mm-hmm.
Right. So imagine if that kind of like animal cunning was met with like an actual like
competence
at the top, you can have a very scary individual that can win over a lot of people. That
Steve Bannon.
Who can win over a lot of people, and then the you know this sort of chattering class wouldn't even know what to do. Mm. You know, we wouldn't even know how to speak to these people, how to come down to their level, how to understand their like the world that they're living in. You know, because we're so separated.
Yeah. No, I think the elite definitely failed the Trump test. The media failed the Trump test, in my view, especially towards the beginning. Basically, a big part of my entry into thinking about politics was that I was as blindsided as almost everyone I know when Trump won. Deeply blind. I was so blindsided, in fact, that me and my friend, who is half Mexican, we cooked a Mexican dinner on the night that night of the election to celebrate Trump's loss before it happened.
Of course.
That's how deluded and arrogant we were, right? Anyway, so Trump wins. My model of reality is broken because I could see how a Romney could beat an Obama. I could see how a McCain could beat a Clinton. I could not see for the life of me how any critical mass of people could find Trump attractive. So I made a horrible prediction. And I think like any good rational person, I realize my model of reality must be very flawed to make a prediction this bad. There must be things I'm missing. And the only explanation on offer from left media was there is a sudden unexplained rise in white supremacy and racism between 2012, when we elected Barack Hussein Obama for the second term,
right,
and 2016.
Well, it was because of Obama. Trump. It was a white lashing.
White lashing that took several years to somehow didn't manifest in his second term. He didn't get trounced in his second term. It somehow waited like...
It was dormant.
Dormancy for 8 years, and then suddenly came up out of nowhere. And not only that, some of the same counties that went for Obama twice are going for Trump. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Some of the same voters that Obama won over are now going for Trump. Mm-hmm. So the explanation is a sudden, massive spike in white supremacy. That seemed to me to be very implausible.
Or misogyny, massive misogyny against Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that seemed to me to be not plausible. And I became curious, like, what is it that I'm missing? And I think the biggest thing I was missing was the degree to which people hate elites and the degree to which elites don't make an effort to understand what is outside of their bubble, right? We all live in bubbles, and that's okay. I don't think it can actually be avoided. No one can live a statistically random life, you know, encountering a representative sample of the world. Nobody
insane making
could live that way. It's fine. But if you're in a position of power, whether that is in the mainstream media or in government, you have a responsibility, I think, to take an interest in understanding the ways in which the walls of your bubble may be distorting the screen of your bubble, may be distorting the outside world. Mm-hmm. And elites have perpetually make such little effort to do this. And I think that, as you say, it creates an opportunity for politicians that understand that divide very well and very intuitively to get support way out of proportion to actually how good they are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or even somebody like a politician that comes from the elite who understands that mm-hmm. the elite are only speaking to each other and for each other. Mm-hmm. You know, the idea that we're trying to impress each other as much as possible and get on top of like the social ladder or prestige ladder of our very elitist occupation, whatever. And then if you have somebody from within the circle who understands this is what's going on here, you know, I understand how this works. So I also understand what buttons to push to get them going.
I think George W. Bush was like that a little bit.
Yeah.
I mean, his evangelical side, just he was an absolute elite, right? I mean, could not be more elite than the Bush family.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But he had a kind of populist flavor to him because
he was the average person liked
him. And he was also talking about God a lot and Jesus. And at that time, that was a very populist kind of sensibility.
Yeah. And now you have politicians saying Latinx, like that's a real thing.
Yeah, that in particular, a lot of people make fun of it as like this extreme, like it's this extreme thing you're nutpicking, you know, when you point out the Latinx usage and how it's increased. Yes, it's nutpicking, but there are also interesting reasons to believe that, good reasons to believe that such an extreme case, such an extreme departure from reality illustrates something really important about what's going on, mm-hmm. you know, like almost like where there's smoke, where there's fire, but it's almost like there's fire, you know, like in this, mm-hmm. in this tiny place, like something is going
well,
on.
Well, people are whispering in their ears.
Yeah.
I mean, Joe Biden just has people whispering in his ear. Oh, talk to Dylan Mulvaney.
Yeah.
This is stunning and brave. Yeah. Say Latinx. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
That's terrifying.
It's terrifying that then there's just like, okay.
Yeah.
Sure.
And there's no check on it. There's no, right. literally no adults in the room.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah. And that's what happens with these campaigns is, I mean, I remember with the Latinx issue, because I'm half Puerto Rican and I have a lot of family that I spent a lot of time with as a kid in the Bronx that were working class. When I got to, I was almost fluent at Spanish when I was probably 11 or 12 years old, and I've kind of receded a bit since then. But when I got to Colombia and suddenly people were saying Latinx, I thought that was hilarious because I could just imagine how funny that would be to my Puerto Rican extended family,
mm-hmm.
and how seriously kids seem to be taking it, like as if that's what the Hispanic community is asking to be called.
Mm-hmm.
And so that just seemed very emblematic to me of the different, you know, everyone going to work for the Biden administration, for example, is likely coming disproportionately from places like Colombia, where such things are taken seriously and alleged to be the desires of the community in question. Right, it's always presented as if this is a bottom-up demand,
yeah. mm-hmm.
for recognition and respect, mm-hmm. from the Latino community,
yeah.
in America to be called this way. They are done with the gender binary of their beautiful language that's meticulously and fully gendered and beautifully gendered for hundreds or thousands of years. That, you know, so and people fall for this stuff. I mean, with that particular case, I wasn't going to fall for it because I had a real life connection to that community. So it's easier to not fall for the bullshit in that sense. But on the other hand, there's lots of other Hispanic kids at Columbia that had a real life connection and had as many aunts and uncles who would laugh at that word as I did, but nevertheless really took it seriously too. So.
They went back home and used that word with their like Latin family?
Probably in that obnoxious way,
probably,
because it's a way of striving.
Probably got laughed at
because
by
it's,
everyone.
But it's also class striving.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
it's
right.
A, it's a social.
That's exactly
it's
what
a
it
social
is.
Signifier. It's a class signifier. Yeah. So I'm sure they went back to their parents and were insufferable.
Yeah,
yeah. yeah.
The
yeah,
way right. that, you know, you come back from your junior year abroad with a foreign accent.
Right.
You know, it's an
right.
affect.
Yeah, I think that it's the kinds of people who like absorb these kinds of norms, I would never articulate it that way, but these are obviously the values and worldview and viewpoints and signifiers of elite liberal whites,
class,
you know, like
well,
but specifically
it's a
white elite, you know, and yeah. I think that's one of the more interesting developments of our political era, to see like educated liberal whites turn so so into the Democratic Party and become this like very powerful base within the Democratic Party. They're going to run the Democratic Party. They are running the Democratic Party. And what will that do to what used to be an important, you know, layer of, you know, Democratic politics,
right.
which was like class and issues
yeah.
of class.
Unions and grassroots movements. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, I've a couple friends that never tire of pointing out that when Biden won the re-election from Trump, he didn't get rid of any of the tax breaks and tax cuts that people were crying bloody murder about when Trump implemented them. And Chuck Schumer didn't change the salt tax for New Yorkers and like all this stuff. None of it happened because it's actually not necessarily the Democratic Party is no longer the party of the working class.
Yeah.
It's the party of the college educated.
It's focusing
college
on student debt versus medical debt
and minorities.
You know, like
yeah.
if you're talking about debt relief,
yeah.
there's debt that's held by marginalized, quote unquote, people, and
yeah.
then there's debt that's held by people who tend to do better off.
Yeah.
And which do they choose? Which do they obsess over? Which do they talk about all the time and campaign about all the time? Because they know that that's their base and that's who's worth pandering to. And right. The interesting thing is that it's actually a very powerful base. Like, this is money, you know, mm-hmm. like these are the people with money. And they're going to blast the airwaves with this, you know, like with the ideology that they share and the values that they share. And it's going to be strange.
Yeah, strange indeed.
Yeah, it's interesting because you have like that like biracial background.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you which side do you identify as biracial? Like what's, or is there like a prominent, like there's some.
Yeah, interesting. I guess so like as a kid, pre-awareness of politics or culture, I would say I'm half Black, half Puerto Rican. Mm-hmm. In no particular order. Mm-hmm. I spent probably like as a young kid, I spent more time with the Puerto Rican half of my family. Mm-hmm. And as a teenager, I spend more time with the Black half of my family. Mm-hmm. Overall, it's probably comparable. Mm-hmm. And I just felt like I had that like split identity. Like it was a clear difference in my mind. Like everyone spoke Spanish on one side and everyone was American, Black American on the other side. And it was like culturally very different, but I felt like I was in both. I did notice as I got older that more and more, and I think this is like as a result of social feedback, because like identity can be partly the what you put out there, but partly what you're getting back, mm-hmm. is that I got back that I was Black.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like just Black. So I think I started subconsciously being more likely to just check the Black box, mm-hmm. at certain points. And I may have also been getting feedback that to be Black is really to have a huge advantage, mm-hmm. in some ways, when you're applying to colleges, for example. So I guess, does that answer the question?
I think it's not quite biracial. It's interesting, because, I was thinking about like our vice president, uh-huh. and how she's Black. She's like also Indian. She's South Asian.
Yeah.
Right. And the latter half of her identity is just like invisible.
It's never discussed. Yeah.
And part of it might be that she kind of looks Black-ish, more Black than Indian, I would say.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
And her
yeah.
sister looks very Indian, which is interesting.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Do you know she was in the same economics club as my father in college.
Interesting.
They both went to Howard, and there's a graduate picture of their club. It's like eight people. It's like a tiny club with my dad.
Were they friends?
No, they weren't.
Okay. That's yeah. interesting.
Yeah, it is.
Cool. Well, when she's president, maybe you'll have an in.
Maybe. I don't think she's ever going to be president. No, oh my God.
Not. It's like the Hillary problem. Oh, but
it's worse, actually.
Worse, yeah. Worse.
She's much worse than Hillary, I think, in terms of her gaffes and her inability to string a coherent sentence together sometimes.
Yeah, yeah. Hillary seems...
Well, Hillary has a gravitas at the end of the day that Kamala just... Yeah. She's giggly. I mean, it's nervous laughter.
Yes, Hillary could be giggly right. too. But that was like the lowest points of her public appearances right. was when she tried to be like lighthearted cackling, fun.
But she was right. pretending to be yeah. silly.
That's
yeah,
right. And it was clearly a pretense.
Yes.
That's what rubbed people the wrong way. Kamala, she just seems like genuinely nervous and kind of unprepared and not suited to the task.
She just, and she was perfectly suited to her previous task. This is the thing, is I don't understand why people want this job. Mm-hmm. I always thought this about Obama.
Well, because like, it puts you in line. Oh, you mean the vice presidency?
Yeah, or? Like the presidency was like beneath him with Obama. Like he should have been on the Supreme Court. Being the president or the vice president, it's not like a job for an intellectual. It's a job for somebody who is a performer and is a horse trader, like a politician, like Bill Clinton.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I feel like the elites, that's another thing, is we want people who look like us and think like us to be in leadership positions. Like we loved Obama because it was like a walking NPR interview who also happened to be Black.
Well, yeah. but
he was Obama, the whole package.
Really, yeah, I mean, he's a once in a lifetime talent in the sense that he is exactly what elite Americans want to elect, but he also has genuinely no air of condescension towards non-elites and towards the working class. He's like a unicorn in being able to genuinely appeal to the elite and to the non-elite. Like if you saw that speech he gave a couple months ago where he talks about Social Security and how, you know, people have the chapped hands to show that they've earned their Social Security, gave me goosebumps. But it also really appealed to people who have injuries because they've like worked, they work jobs with their bodies their whole lives. And he is somehow able to walk that line and appeal to both in a way that almost no politician.
But he was a great candidate. Really, I'm not sure he was such a great politician. Obama's a perfect candidate.
He was a perfect candidate.
What do you mean? Oh, you mean as opposed to a governor?
Yeah. I don't think that he really, I always felt like he wasn't actually interested in the job. Yeah. Like he was put forth because he was such an irresistible candidate.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But, no, I always felt that the job he was wasted on him.
Interesting.
Yeah.
There was just, I think a lot of people could see a little bit of themselves in Obama. You know, there was a part of the country that couldn't at all. Mm-hmm. But I think maybe that this was part of his like, you know, his skill at creating a, you know, a kind of person that everyone can see something about. You know, about themselves in him. Mm-hmm. Like for me, I liked that he was like this third culture kid, even though he pretended not to be. Like he was a very like I'm black. But people who basically they grow. There's the idea that you'd grow up in multiple cultures, multiple immigrant kids, like two cultures, or you live in like another country, or you move around a lot. But he, you know, grew up in like all kinds of different places, and was exposed to a lot of different kinds of living and lifestyles and values. And so those are like third culture people that don't have this, that cosmopolitan kind of culture, kinda, but they don't really have a whole set of anything. And I felt that intuitively about Obama, even though he did make a point to emphasize his like blackness.
Yeah. Oh, when he started talking with the black cadence, it was cringe, don't you think?
I don't know. I was 12 years old at the time. Okay. I didn't think it was cringe, but I don't think my phony detectors are quite as sensitive as yours.
I just, it's like, dude, you don't talk like this.
I felt that he was emphasizing it. I don't know if I'd felt it was phony, because there is an extent to which you do speak differently. Like the code switching thing is real. Like I do speak differently with my mother than I do with you. You know, the kind of inflection. I you know, it just, that's a common thing. So maybe
with her mother.
Yeah. I want you to talk. Yeah, please talk that way to me. No,
really.
You want her to speak in Urdu to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
Awesome.
For coming on my show, and you're welcome for coming on yours.
Yeah, this is whose show is it anyway? We'll let the audience decide.
There we go.
We'll let them decide who won.
Yeah,
Won? This has been a debate.
There we go.
This whole time.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Thank you, Coleman.
Right.
This was
thank
great.
You.
Yeah,
thank you.
That was our interview with Coleman Hughes. It was so good. I don't think we need bonus content.
Yeah, I don't think we do. It was quite long, too. So a reminder to everybody, if you enjoyed it, we enjoyed doing it, please subscribe on, you know, wherever you get, you know, your podcast, and rate us and review us. We're on YouTube now. If you are just an audio listener, just a reminder that you can see our faces if you go on YouTube.
Coiffed?
And our perfectly coiffed hair.
I think it's coiffed.
Coiffed? Is that how you say it? No, you don't say it like
that's
coiffed.
The American pronunciation.
Meghan.
Yeah, no, Meghan, you're much more coiffed than
I am. I'm coiffed. I'm coiffed.
My hair is Meghan problematic.
Is yeah, so you can see our lovely faces and awkward gestures throughout our conversations. If you go to our YouTube, and it's just type in A Special Place in Hell and you'll find it. And you can subscribe there. We have our website as well, which is aspecialplaceinhell.org, which is very exciting. Org, that means we're intellectual.
Oh, for sure.
Yes. You are definitely making the world a better place if you go to our website and enable us by supporting us in one of the many ways we now offer. Or could have fed them, but instead it will go to our hair quaffing.
Yeah, but that's a good cause. So yes, so they can, you know, support us on the Substack, all of the usual places. And if you're confused, you can go to aspecialplaceinhell.org and learn everything about us. So that's that. All right, we'll see you in hell.
All right. Thanks, everyone.